topic of discussion for today is cholinergic system. Cholinergic system means it is a type of autonomic nervous system in which the neurotransmitter is acetylcholine. That is why it is called cholinergic system. So we know that in cholinergic system, the major neurotransmitter is acetylcholine. This acetylcholine is obtained from acetyl coenzyme A and choline. And this reaction is catalyzed by the enzyme choline acetyl transferase. This reaction takes place inside the axon. That is, we know that the nerve consists of a dendrite, cell body, axon, etc. And this takes place in the cell body and axon. And the acetylcholine that is formed as a result of this reaction is stored inside the they are stored inside the vesicles. So there are different two methods of storage. That is, some of them are stored inside the vesicles or synaptic vesicles, and the remaining that is present inside the ionic medium of the axon. So and in acetylcholine, when there is a message or anything has to be transferred, this acetylcholine, the synaptic vesicles containing the acetylcholine will move towards this, axon endings, and from there is the synaptic vesicles are released in from the synaptic vesicles, the acetylcholine is released into the space between the anything. That is, it can connect between two nerves or between a nerve and a muscle. That is called neuromuscular junction, and in that synaptic space, it is released, and this is responsible for the effects of the acetylcholine. So after the reaction, this acetylcholine is degraded by the enzyme acetylcholine esterase into acetic acid and choline. So the two important things that we have to remember here is that I told about the mechanism. So we know that there is an enzyme called choline acetyl transferase that is responsible for the formation of acetylcholine. This choline acetyl transferase is inhibited by the compound hemicholinium. So this hemicholinium blocks the formation of acetylcholine and thereby prevents the triggering or prevents the transfer of information via acetylcholine, the signal transduction. Now another important is that as I have already mentioned, this acetylcholine is present inside the synaptic vesicles. The transfer of acetylcholine into the synaptic vesicles containing the acetylcholine. This acetylcholine has to be transferred into the vesicles. So this transfer of acetylcholine into the vesicle is blocked by another compound called vesamicol. So this is regarding the introduction of acetylcholine receptors. That is, acetylcholine is produced by the help of the enzyme choline acetyl transferase, which is blocked by hemicholinium. And the transfer of the acetylcholine into the vesicles is blocked by another compound called vesamicol. So both of this, as we can see, both of them inhibit the functioning of acetylcholine. We know that acetylcholine is the neurotransmitter in the case of cholinergic system. This acetylcholine can exert its action via two receptors. They are the muscarinic receptors and nicotinic receptors. The naming of these receptors is based on the selective agonist of this receptor. That is, muscarinic receptor has a selective agonist called muscarin, and nicotinic receptor is affected by nicotine. That is why this name is given. So acetylcholine as a neurotransmitter can exert its peripheral action with the help of the two receptors, muscarinic receptors and nicotinic receptors. These receptors play the most important role in the signal transduction using acetylcholine. It is because of the inhibition of these receptors that majority of anticholinergics function. And via these receptors, is the cholinergic, the mainstay of cholinergic system functioning is based on these two receptors. Now coming on to this, based on the different types of mechanism of action and how the signal is transduced, each of these receptors has got certain subtypes. So we are going on to the different subtypes of muscarinic and nicotinic receptors. First coming on to muscarinic receptors. This muscarinic receptors, we know that the agonist for muscarinic receptor is muscarin and the antagonist for muscarinic receptor is atropin. So atropin is the antagonist for muscarinic receptor. Now depending upon the different mechanism of action and different interactions and the chemical constituents and composition, the receptors, there are different subtypes of this muscarinic receptors. We have five different types of muscarinic receptors: M1, M2, M3, M4 and M5. Out of this, M4 and M5 has no role in the peripheral action and hence it is present in the brain, and most of the functions in the brain, as it acts as a neurotransmitter in the brain, so that all functions are through M4 and M5 receptors, but it is not important in the case of our discussion of the peripheral effect of acetylcholine. So what we do, that we mainly concentrate on these three receptors, that is M1, M2 and M3, based on which the mainstay of cholinergics as well as anticholinergics is based. So each of these has got its own unique effect. We know that, first coming on to the M1. This M1 receptor, the mechanism of action is that when acetylcholine binds to M1 receptor, this receptor is bound to a GQ protein. So basically, all the muscarinic receptors are G protein coupled receptors. So M1 functions through GQ protein or GQ receptor, GQ protein coupled receptor. The function of the GQ protein is it maintains its function, acts via the inositol phosphate and diacetylglycerol pathway, and it increases the cytosolic calcium 2+ level. So it increases the cytosolic calcium 2+ level. This is the first mechanism. And the second mechanism is through phospholipase A2. So we know that the different types of transfer or signal transduction by receptors. The GQ protein coupled receptors transduct information via the IP3 DAG and phospholipase A2. So this increases the cytosolic calcium 2+, and this is the prostaglandins, that is membrane phospholipids are converted into, and that is the action of phospholipase A2. So these two function together to bring about the signal transduction via the M1 receptors. Similarly, coming on to the M3 receptor also, the same mechanism of action, that is it function via a GQ protein coupled receptor with the same action like IP3 DAG and phospholipase A2, increase in the cytosolic calcium 2+ level, and this is responsible for the functioning. Now the difference is in the case of M2, this is very important because this M2 receptor, it acts via a G inhibitory protein. It's also called GAO G0, that is it is a G inhibitory protein. So it results in potassium channel opening that causes hyperpolarization, and there is a decrease in the response. So this is basically an inhibitory cycle. That is the main difference between these two receptors. So M1 and M3, they function through GQ protein coupled receptors, whereas M2 functions through a G inhibitory protein coupled receptor. So the main action of it is an inhibitory cycle. Coming on to M1 receptor. As we said earlier, it is based on IP3 DAG and also phospholipase A2 and prostaglandin synthesis. So it is basically an activation. So this basically acts on autonomic ganglia. Since it is an activation pathway in autonomic ganglia, it causes depolarization. Next, it acts on gastric glands. Gastric glands the main function of M1 receptor in gastric glands, it causes histamine release and acid secretion. There are two important functions, that is gastric glands it act by histamine release and acid secretion. Histamine release itself is a trigger for acid secretion. So the main function of M1 receptor, acetylcholine through M1 receptor on gastric glands is acid secretion. Now coming on to CNS. It helps in various functions like learning, memory, etc. So these are the major functions of M1 receptor. As we said earlier, M1 receptor is an activation pathway. So through activation pathway in autonomic ganglia, it causes depolarization. In gastric glands, it causes acid secretion. And in CNS, it helps in learning and memory. Now, the other important details of this M1 receptor are, each of these receptor, that is M1, M2, M3, has got its own selective agonist and selective antagonist. In case of M1 receptor, the selective agonist is oxytremorin and the selective antagonist is pyrenceptin. So this is basically about the M1 receptor. The M1 receptor, as we said, it has three important functions. It acts on autonomic ganglia, it acts on CNS, and it acts on gastric glands. In autonomic ganglia, it causes depolarization. On gastric glands, it causes acid secretion. And in CNS, it causes learning, memory, and helps in other functions. And selective agonist is oxytremorin, and selective antagonist is pyrenceptin. This is basically about the M1 receptors. Coming on to M2 receptor. As we said earlier, the M2 receptor is an inhibitory cycle, that is, it acts via the opening of potassium channel, and the opening of potassium channel causes decrease in the amount of cyclic AMP, which is a second messenger. So this acts as an inhibitory cycle. So the functions of this receptors is very easy to remember. Because it is an inhibitory cycle, the major functions are like this. It acts on SA node, it acts on AV node, atria, ventricle, it acts on CNS, and it acts on visceral smooth muscles. Since it is an inhibitory, it acts via a inhibitory receptor, that is G inhibitory protein coupled receptor, then decreases the cyclic AMP. So it is an inhibitory action. So on SA node, it causes inhibition and decreases the contractility, decreases the excitability and contractility of SA node. Therefore, it decreases the heart rate, causes bradycardia. Now coming on to AV node, it also causes decrease in the AV, the excitation of the AV node, and also on the AV conduction. It also decreases the AV conduction and decreases the excitability of AV node. Therefore, it causes AV node dysfunction. That is, decreases the conductivity, that is the signal conduction from the atrium to the ventricle is decreased in the presence of acetylcholine if it acts through the M2 receptor. This M2 receptor is mainly present in the heart, and it causes this much functions. Then in SA node, it causes decrease in the excitability and causes bradycardia. AV node, it decreases the AV conduction, thereby decreases the transport of signals from the atria to the ventricle. In atria also, it decreases the contractility of atria, decreases the contractility of ventricles. And in CNS, it causes two effects. It causes tremors and analgesia. This analgesia is also based on the inhibitory effect, that it causes analgesia, that is decrease in pain. And this tremors, the tremors is basically based because it exerts an inhibitory effect on the inhibitory cycle. Usually there is an inhibitory cycle that suppresses the tremors. When that inhibitory cycle is inhibited by the M2 receptors in CNS, it causes tremors. And in the visceral smooth muscles, it causes contraction. So these are the major functions. It's a inhibitory cycle. So because inhibition causes bradycardia, decrease AV conduction, decreases the contractility of ventricles, decreases the contractility of atria. In CNS it causes tremors and analgesia, and visceral smooth muscles it causes contraction. Now, as in the earlier group, it also has got a selective agonist, and the selective agonist in this is called methacholine. And the selective antagonist is tripitramine. The selective agonist is methacholine and the selective antagonist is tripitramine. This is about the M2 receptors. Now coming on to the third type, that is M3. M3 muscarinic receptors, as we know, the pathway is IP3 DAG pathway or phospholipase A2 resulting in prostaglandin synthesis. So this is an activation pathway. So the action, the basic major actions, this has got the major actions, that is M3 receptors are basically present in the visceral smooth muscles. The major action of acetylcholine on the visceral smooth muscles is through M3 receptors, and so this is very important. In visceral smooth muscles, it causes contraction. This is the very important function of acetylcholine acting via M3 receptor. It causes contraction of visceral smooth muscles. Other important function is it acts on iris. It causes constriction of the pupil. Similarly, it acts on vascular endothelial cells. In vascular endothelial cells, it causes vasodilatation. This is because it acts on the vascular endothelial cells, and the presence of we know that there is as we discussed about the mechanism of action of M3 receptor, we said that it is based on IP3 DAG pathway that increases the cytosolic calcium 2+. This cytosolic calcium 2+ binds to the calmodulin that is present in the cytosol, and this calcium calmodulin complex. This calcium calmodulin complex increases the action of nitric oxide synthase. So this nitric oxide synthase results in the formation of nitric oxide. So when acetylcholine acts via the M3 receptors on vascular endothelial cells, it helps in the release of nitric oxide, and this nitric oxide is responsible for the vasodilatation. So it is not due to a direct action, it is through the synthesis of nitric oxide it acts on the vascular endothelial smooth muscles. Now it acts on the ciliary muscles. Ciliary muscles also, there will be contraction. So these are the main important functions. This acts on the most important function, it acts on visceral smooth muscles, results in contraction of visceral smooth muscles. It acts on iris, it causes constriction. On ciliary muscles, it causes contraction. And in vascular endothelial cells, through the synthesis of nitric oxide, it results in vasodilatation. So these are the major actions of acetylcholine through the M3 receptors. So M3 receptor is very important in the case of the peripheral action of acetylcholine. And the selective agonist is bethanicol. And the selective antagonist is diphenhydramine. So selective agonist is bethanicol and antagonist is diphenhydramine. So this is in short about the M3 receptors. And so we have completed the muscarinic receptors. Now moving on to the nicotinic receptors. Now as we have discussed about the muscarinic receptors, now coming on to the nicotinic receptors. There are two types of nicotinic receptors, that is NM and NL. This NM is the major receptor that is present in the neuromuscular junction. So when acetylcholine acts via the NM nicotinic receptor, it results in the contraction of skeletal muscles. So we have earlier said that the contraction of the visceral smooth muscles is through the muscarinic receptors, whereas the contraction of skeletal muscles is through the nicotinic receptors, particularly the NM type. This nicotinic receptor NM type, the major difference between the muscarinic receptor and the nicotinic receptor is that in case of muscarinic receptors, we have said that it acts via a G protein coupled receptor, whereas this is a ligand gated ion channel. The nicotinic receptors are basically ligand gated ion channels. So the ligand is actually this acetylcholine. This when binds to it, it results in the opening of cation channels. So it has got an intrinsic ion channel present inside, and this results in the opening of cation channels. It is the mechanism of action. It results in the opening of cation channels. And so opening of cation channels, particularly sodium and potassium. The cation channels are opened, and this is responsible for the depolarization and contraction of the skeletal muscles. This is the basic function of NM type of receptor. And the selective agonist, as we have already said, is given the name nicotinic because the selective agonist is nicotine. Now coming on to the selective antagonist. Tubocurarin acts as the selective antagonist. So selective agonist is nicotine and the selective antagonist is tubocurarin. This is about the NM type of receptor. Now coming on to the NN type of receptor. This NN type of receptor has two sites. It is present in the autonomic ganglia. And it is also present in the adrenal medulla. In autonomic ganglia, it causes depolarization. And in adrenal medulla, it causes increase in the catecholamine release. The mechanism of action is same. It has got an intrinsic ion channel and results in the opening of cation channels, that is sodium, potassium and calcium channels. It's opening of sodium, potassium and calcium cation channels, and it is responsible for the major functioning of this NN type of receptors. And the selective agonist is nicotine, and the selective antagonist in the case of NN type is hexamethonia. So basically two types of nicotinic receptors, NM and NN. NM acts on the neuromuscular junction, results in the contraction of skeletal muscles. It acts via the opening of cation channels like sodium and potassium. Selective agonist is nicotine and the selective antagonist is tubocurarin. Now NN, it acts in autonomic ganglia, it causes depolarization, and in adrenal medulla it causes increase in the catecholamine release. It also functions by the opening of the cation channels of sodium, potassium and calcium. The selective agonist is nicotine and the selective antagonist is hexamethonia. So by this, we complete the discussion about the major receptors that are involved in the peripheral cholinergic system.